You're listening to the ESO Network, your station for all things geek.
And we're back. We're back for another round of podcasting. It is me, your host, Deadpool Speaks, and you're listening to Chimichanga Talk. And along today with me on this very special WrestleMania episode is our very own One Job. Say hello, One Job.
Hello.
And what we're going to be doing is we're going to be doing some WrestleMania predictions. We're going to be calling out exactly what we think is going to happen at WrestleMania. And before we do that, though, I do want to go ahead and kind of give us our own little shout-out, as we always do. So Chimichanga Talk is found on all your greatest podcast hosting sites. From iTunes to SoundCloud, just search us out. Remember to visit us on our website at www.chimichangatalk.com for all of our latest updates and appearances. Remember to also speak out to us, reach out to us, touch us. In an appropriate manner, on Facebook and on Instagram. You can find us under Chimichanga Talk as well. And also follow me on Twitter at Deadpool Speaks. You can follow Dr. Evil Beard there as well. And remember, also, if you are on Instagram and you like movies, definitely check out One Job's Movie Geek. It's Movie Geek 98.
Movie Geek underscore 98.
On Instagram for all your latest movie news, birthdays, and reviews. He does an amazing job there. So if you're a cinephile, yeah, that word just sounds dirty. Go ahead and check that out. Again, that's MovieGeek underscore 98 on Instagram. So let's get right into it because this is going to be a super tight episode. We're actually going to be live at WrestleMania this year.
Yes, we are. And to be honest, by the way it's game build up, I want to sell my tickets.
Wow, that goes a long way to say, because here's the thing, you know, at this particular WrestleMania, we're saying that we might see the end of The Undertaker. So basically, this might be the last time we get to see The Undertaker.
Yes.
It's going to be in a capacity crowd. Now, the thing is, with Orlando, it's an open-air stadium. So that means anything can happen. It means that, you know, UFOs could abduct who knows what. You could have CM Punk coming in from the crowd, which I doubt.
Lady Gaga dropping in from the sky.
Yeah, you never know. Lady Gaga's been known to do that. And one of the most amazing things about WrestleMania is the way that it invades the town. Basically, it's become a pulp culture event, what they call, when they take over the town, they got a wrestling belt, like the world
like,
title.
It's in one of the, I forgot the area. It was like one of those lakes in Orlando. One of the many lakes
of Orlando. and not only that, but you got Walt Culture Wrestling is going to be doing a show there. You got the Hardy Boys. They're going to be doing like their own little thing there.
You have NXT doing their own little takeover.
Yeah, on Saturday. And we're going to be visiting Access. So Chimichanga Talk is going to be going live from Access and from WrestleMania. So at least you can count us on, you know, in for that. And the reason we wanted to do this show is because we wanted to do kind of like a prediction show like everybody else does.
Yeah.
Might as well go with the flow and join the sheep. And, you know, since we're really excited because this is like a bucket list item for us. And you may have heard on our last episode, I talked about the things that are going wrong with wrestling. I said, you know, the whole thing about commentators and not having a really good balance between a heel commentator and a face commentator. Now everything kind of blends in together.
Not only that, but also as well on SmackDown with all those many commentator seats. Man, even JBL is tripping on them.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, that's an interesting fact because they mentioned that before, that maybe before the dynamic worked really well, you had, you know, a heel wrestler and a face wrestler. I'm sorry, commentator, that were supporting, you know, the face, you know, wrestler and the heel wrestler.
Yeah.
But now you have three, four, you know, plus guest wrestler commentators, which is shit. I really don't like that. I'll be honest with you.
To be honest, I think the only good commentator on there will probably be Corey Graves on Raw. He actually does a pretty good job as the heel commentator for that brand. But other than that, the rest are kind of what was his name from SmackDown? Mario?
Yeah, Mario, not worth my time, pretty much.
He's pretty good, too.
But
good at screaming Mamma Mia.
Oh, that guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, Mamma Mia, oh my. But the thing is, it's getting stale. It seems like almost, like with every wrestling game that's come out in the last couple of years, the commentating track has been kind of repetitive and predictable. So it's not what it used to be. But, I mean, I get it. I get it when you watch, like, Lucha Underground and things like that, where you have Vampiro commentating.
And Matt Stryker.
And Matt Stryker.
Consider him one of the better commentators from WWE.
Exactly. I mean, you see a notable difference. You see how that dual commentator thing works. I mean, when you think back, and this is a really good example, when you had a WrestleMania, what was it, WrestleMania 9 with Bret Hart and Yokozuna and all that.
Yeah.
And just that happened.
The Olympic Stadium one.
Yes. Okay. And on that call, you had Macho Man, you had Jim Ross.
Yeah, that was his first time.
Uh-huh. You had Bobby the Brain Heenan. And the thing is, it seems like they were talking over each other. The Macho Man wanted to say something, he'd get cut off. And you got to remember, a lot of these commentators are being yelled at, you know, through their headphones, kind of saying, okay, well, you're going to say this, you're going to say that. And how many times have we seen, like, on shows, you know, like on YouTube shows like Botchamania and stuff like that?
Yeah.
You see how they're talking to the people in the back, instead of kind of letting them go loose, which I think really works. But, you know, we talked about that. We talked about the poor storylines.
Yeah.
The lack of respect for the belt, which is, you know, I was watching, most recently, like a piece that they did on the WWE Network for Mr. Fuji. And, it was a match, Mr. Fuji versus Bruno Sammartino. And the match was not big moves. The match was just simply a lot of arm drags. There was even what I call the titty pinch hold kind of thing. It's a pressure hold. It's under the arm. But before, wrestling was more about the buildup. And I think the biggest bump that was taken was Mr. Fuji thrown off the top rope after he was going to go ahead and kind of do a splash from the top. And nowadays, I think that a lot of the audience is expecting a lot of, you know, just big bumps. Maybe it's the attention span. What do you think is going wrong with the in-ring action?
Like you said, I think that's what it is. They're doing a lot of big moves. Like, a finisher is not even a finisher anymore. It's like it's expected to see the 1-2 kick out whenever they hit the finisher, basically the John Cena effect, you know.
Yeah.
A finisher doesn't end the match. It's the 1-2, ooh, kick out, you know, to get the crowd on their feet, kind of like Macho Man versus Ricky Steamboat, whenever they keep having the 1-2, the 1-2.
Exactly.
It's kind of like that.
And that's the buildup that everybody's talking about. That's the thing that I think is really crucial. And, you know, they're trying to fill a lot of this time. You know, with the shows, I mean, you're talking about, you know, 2 hour shows, you know, twice a week. I mean, with different wrestlers.
Well, with Raw, you have 3 hours as well.
Yeah.
So pay-per-view length, basically.
Exactly. And now I think that they're trying to squeeze so much in, and so they compress the matches. I mean, you're not going to see another Iron Man match that's an hour long. The Iron Man matches are now 30 minutes, at the most.
And look at the cruiserweights, because sometimes they will have their one match a week on Raw, sometimes even two, and their matches are like 3 to 4 minutes long, barely get any time in the ring.
Exactly. And I think that's part of the dynamic that we're seeing is that you don't have those long matches anymore. You don't have that buildup where, you know, they're working the arm, they're trying to go ahead and... Because before, I don't know if you remember, at WCW, they used to cut to commercials in the middle of matches because they would go on so long.
Heck, didn't one of the pay-per-views, like, go overtime and no one got a chance to figure out the finale of that pay-per-view?
Yeah.
I think it was a Halloween Havoc with
Goldberg.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, and the thing is, you know, in the defense of the wrestlers, a lot of time they get the cues from backstage. Like, for example, what was it, the ladder match between Razor Ramon and Shawn Michaels, that they had to cut out a whole entire match because the referee kept telling them to go home, which, you know, in wrestling speak, go home means basically finish the match. Let's go ahead and get that ending piece in there. And they just continued fighting because, I mean, it was just built up. And, I mean, it's considered one of the greatest matches in you know, WrestleMania history.
Yeah, that also defined the ladder match.
Mm-hmm.
That truly put both Razor and Shawn Michaels on the map.
Exactly, exactly. And it's looked at by a lot as a pinnacle of this is the kind of match you want to have. But that because that match went over, I mean, they got yelled at, you know, and a whole bunch of people like X-Pac, a 1-2-3 kid, you
never
know.
Never got to WrestleMania. Never got to wrestle.
Yeah, well, they got he got his WrestleMania moment, like, I think 6 years later.
Yeah, like in 15, I want to say, which is crazy to think that he'd gone on that long without appearing in a WrestleMania.
Well, I mean, he was always kind of like mid-card status. He never really blew up very big, even though he had the 1-2-3 kid gimmick and he was a high flyer. He just wasn't considered, you know, anything big back in the day. But, you know, this is one of the biggest problems that we're having. This is why WrestleMania is not as anticipated by actual hardcore wrestling fans. It's more of a spectacle. You know, it's not really the Super Bowl of you know, the wrestling world because, you know, a Super Bowl means that you follow the team the whole time. You're invested. That's a word I keep using. You're invested in the story. But I mean, I don't necessarily feel that, you know, going into this WrestleMania. It's why a lot of older viewers have stopped watching WWE. Have moved into shows like, you know, Ring of Honor, Lucha Underground, because of their storytelling, you know? So, that's, you know, that's another thing. And all this rambling around is the reason why, you know, we're going to predict what we are for these particular matches. So we're going to go ahead and get started. First of all, they're going to have, the Andre the Giant Battle Royal. So, you know, Big Show's going to be appearing in this. Big Show's been hyping up the whole Shaquille O'Neal thing.
Not only that, but recently Big Show has been getting, a pretty good push. Like, because I've noticed recently whenever I watch the highlights for Raw, he's on there a lot. More than usual, which I'm like, I wonder where that's going to lead to.
And, you know, it's interesting because he's what I call, like, a revolving door legend, where he's gotten to the point where, yeah, he's a little bit older. It's a little bit more difficult to deal with things. And, I mean, you know, I think Kevin Nash said it best when he's like, when you work with big men, it's difficult to do anything. And, I mean, I think that's kind of hypocritical coming out of his mouth because he's a big guy, you know.
But it's the truth. I mean, they have a very limited moveset.
Exactly.
Very few people can pull off some things like a Rey Mysterio or maybe a, you know, one of those high flyers kind of people.
Yeah, or even like a midway guy like CM Punk. Or, I mean, if you look at like John Cena is a powerhouse because he can not only do the high flying stuff, but, you know.
Badly.
Well, I mean, look at Brock. Okay, Brock at least tried. I mean, he almost killed himself.
But he tried.
He tried.
He gets a gold star for effort.
Exactly. And you know, we're all about participation medals here at Chimichanga Talk. But so Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal, which is, it's, I don't know. I don't, they've done it the last couple of years.
Since 30, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And it I don't know if it's gone over well with the crowd. I don't think it's kind of like a mixed bag.
I mean, last year was interesting since they kind of did what Royal Rumble does. They brought in some unexpected people. Like, you had your Diamond Dallas Page, and I think even Tatanga was in there, too.
Yeah.
Out of all people. But it's an okay match. I'll consider it maybe a bathroom break to some people.
Yeah, so if you're going in really heavy there with your drinking, you know, that's the time to go ahead and go to the bathroom. According to us, that's our prediction. You know, this is a bathroom break moment. But if you had to, you know, I mean, they have Mojo Rawley.
Mojo.
Well, we're in Orlando. We're in Orlando. Okay, that's his Latin talk because, you know, we have mojo and pork, which is like a Cuban thing. So even though it's Mojo, it's Mojo, you know, because it's Orlando. Apollo Crews, Big Show, and then like I said, Shaquille O'Neal might make an appearance. So this is still out. We don't know exactly who's going to be in it. So I mean, would you have any kind of prediction for this, or maybe somebody we might see?
I'll just say, I don't know if they're actually going to go with the Big Show and have him win. It seems like that's what they want to do, but who knows? Maybe they'll have Shaquille come in, maybe throw out Big Show or something.
build the heat?
Yeah, build the heat. I don't know. It's an interesting prediction to make, definitely.
All right, so I mean, we can't really have anything there, so we're just gonna go ahead and kind of toss that one up in the air. Since you know it seems like they're trying to push Big Show, maybe we'll go ahead and say Big Show.
It would be nice to see maybe Apollo Crews win. I mean, he's a good wrestler, especially for his build, but he's been very
well ever since the McMahon incident. You know,
that wasn't him.
I know, but ever since the McMahon incident and everything else, and I don't know what it is. But it, with the exception of New Day, I feel like the African American side of wrestling has taken a huge hit, and I think they don't push wrestlers like that. I mean, look at what is this guy's name? Ahmed Johnson.
True. Yeah.
Okay. Here's a powerhouse that they were trying to build up, and they kind of destroyed him going over with Legion of Doom and everything else. I mean, they've never had a decent push through.
I'll say the only one who kind of did have somewhat of a push, even though it was like 1 month, was when they had R-Truth go heel on Cena. It was actually
R-Truth. Well, you know, because he wasn't he playing like that kind of like kind of crazy angle, little Jimmy angle.
Yeah, the little Jimmy. I think that's where all that started. All the little Jimmys, ignore me.
And you know, it's funny that you bring that up because it's really these kind of weird gimmicks that still get the crowd going.
Yeah.
You know, and speaking of kind of weird gimmicks, we got the Cruiserweight Championship with Neville, right? Which Neville has been, he's a great wrestler, he's just really small, so I don't think he's really been pushed because of that, but he's taking on Austin Aries. Now, Austin Aries he's really well known on the indie circuit, amazing wrestler, so we have two powerhouses of wrestling, technical wrestling,
yeah,
going up against each other.
What's crazy, it's when I first saw Austin Aries, my first exposure to him was with TNA when they first brought him in.
Mm-hmm.
And I considered him I don't know if I'll get like hate on this or whatever, the CM Punk of TNA.
Because
not
that.
Only does he have the look of it, but he also has the mic skills, mm-hmm, and the moves of Punk. So whenever I played WWE 13 or whatever, I had Punk versus Aries because that's like a perfect matchup. Now, I like what they're doing with Neville, having him as the heel, I'm the best cruiserweight of the world.
Well, and you see that yeah, works, because for me, I think the best person to have a title is a heel.
Yeah.
You know, because you want him to do everything that he can to retain that title. I mean, like I said, the biggest exception to the rule, I think, in WWE history, because, you know, look at some of the greatest world champions that were out there. When they were heels, you know, Triple H, you had even Austin when he had his run and he was trying to play the heel.
Yeah.
That was great. Ric Flair, you know, look at how these men held the belt. I mean, even Seth Rollins.
When Seth had the whole...
He was playing like the coward heel, even though you know he was good. It sells it. So I think turning Neville heel and having him retain the belt was fantastic. It was a great idea. So what's your prediction to win this match, the Cruiserweight Championship match?
The way I want to see it, even though I love Austin Aries to death, I think I would want Neville to retain in some way to keep him pushing that whole heel thing and build him up as a more powerful heel than he already is.
No, and I agree 110%.
Yeah.
All right, so we got Neville retaining championship against Austin Aries for the Cruiserweight Champion. Now, next, we have an interesting thing. Now, we have Alexa Bliss versus entire SmackDown, which means every diva that's there, you know, not diva, lady wrestler. I don't know what they want to be called.
Women wrestlers. Jim Cornette will not approve of that.
I know. SmackDown Women's Championship. Now, here's a crazy thing with the SmackDown Women's Championship. So far, from what I understand and reading, a whole bunch of commentary by different. Wrestling blogs out there. From what I understand, WWE is not very happy with Alexa Bliss right now. They are not happy with the way she wrestled, most recently on SmackDown. She's not the champion they want her to be right now. So I'm automatically thinking that we are not gonna see her retain the championship. What do you think?
I wasn't aware of that, actually, that she was getting heat backstage, and more than likely, since now she's going to have that, that belt's going to come off her. It's going to be interesting because you have Becky Lynch, I believe, Mickey James is on there. She's on the SmackDown roster. I can't name anything else because, to be honest, that SmackDown women roster is really weak.
Well, yeah, I mean, they said, they're probably going to, if Naomi gets better, she might be on there. And like I said, I mean, I don't know exactly what's going to happen. We know that, it says every available woman, on the SmackDown roster is going to be, facing her, with the exception of Nikki Bella. So, I mean, it's really kind of up in the air right now.
What I'm wondering is maybe this can be a perfect opportunity to call up someone from the NXT roster, the women division.
Who do you think they would call up?
To be honest, I don't know because I haven't been following up on NXT lately. But the last takeover I saw, even though they're probably not going to call her up because she's in a stable right now, is this one girl who was in Insanity, I believe. I think her name is like Nikki Cross or something. This girl, she took a table bump in the match, which was insane. And she was like that hardcore brawler type, wrestler.
Yeah.
Which is something really rare to see in the women's division.
Okay. I mean, I can agree with that. I mean, one thing's for sure, because she is getting backstage heat and there's like a lot of report on it, I'm pretty sure she's not going to retain her championship. I'm pretty sure we're going to see a change of hands here. So as far as the SmackDown Women's Championship goes, I'm pretty sure we're going to see a change of hands. To who? Who knows? So right now, that's up in the air. Now, coming on that, we got the Raw Tag Team Championship. So you got Luke Gallows and Karl Anderson versus Enzo Amore and Big Cass versus Cesaro
and Sheamus.
And Sheamus. I don't know what to think about this because, first of all, I love Enzo and Cash. Big Cass has always been. I know they've been trying to kind of push him out because they want to break him out as an individual.
Which, to be honest, I really don't want to see because I think they work better as a tag team, even though Enzo barely gets any ring time. He's mostly the guy that gets beat up and then gets the hot tag to Big Cass.
Well, I think that the reason that they're doing that is because of the push to try to separate them, but I think that would be a really bad move. It's the same. My same feeling goes when they started separating the Wyatt family. You have magic with these two. Just like, when you had with the Hart Foundation and things like that. I mean, there's obvious moments where you can have that release, like with the Rockers, Marty Jannetty, great wrestler, but he was shit on the mic. Eventually you had your breakout star, which was Sean. But here they're equal. I think that Enzo, even though he spends most of his time getting beaten up, he does it in such a great way, except for when he botches moves. Because he's, I just think he gets overexcited. It's probably all that chicken he's eating.
That's an interesting commercial.
Yeah. And that's the thing. I'm not ready to give them up as a tag team.
Yeah.
Because what's going to happen is, much like whenever there is a tag team separation, you're going to have Big Cass getting the push and Enzo getting lost in the mix of things.
in the way I see it, if they're going to do the push, and I know how Vince McMahon likes his big, tough men, they're probably going to have Big Cass as the face and probably have Enzo become the heel of it all.
Yeah, and which will build heat, which, like I said, it'll make for an interesting story, but I'm not ready to give that up yet. You know, and so it's a triple threat match, which we've seen before in WrestleMania. The biggest reason, I don't know why they're doing this as a triple threat match, could be somebody is, you know, slightly injured. I haven't read anything in the board, but they've done this before.
Yeah.
Where, you know, to keep one wrestler, you know, kind of wrestling and in public view, but who needs, you know, some time, they'll usually go ahead and turn something like this into triple threat. Now, Luke Gallows and Carl Anderson, which, you know, formerly known as... you know, the Bullet Club.
Yeah, the Bullet Club.
Which I say that only because of the fact that they've really tamed them down, which I hate.
Definitely.
At
least Carl Anderson had an opportunity to call out his hot Asian wife in one of the promos, but other than that, it's basically they're not even what they used to have been in like the indie scene and in New Japan. They really have changed.
Exactly. And I mean, as much as I would love to see Enzo and Cass get the title,
I would want it to stay on.
I want to see what the Bullet Club or the group formerly known as Bullet Club or you know,
I think it's called just the Club.
Just the Club. I want to see them retain the title, and I want to see what they do. Like I said, I really want to see AJ Styles form a faction. Okay, here's another thing that I think you need that dynamic. I think that with the Authority gone, which the Authority wasn't that great to begin with, but with the Authority gone, with people like, what was it? What was the name of the group with Ric Flair and everything?
Evolution.
Evolution, there you go.
When they had that whole S.H.I.E.L.D. Evolution thing.
Exactly. You need an authoritative group, you know, like these freaking tyrants to be... you know, kind of dominating the field. They need to own the belts. They need to kind of, you know, say, hey, we're the best. Mm-hmm. AJ Styles has an incredible potential to go ahead and do this.
Not only Styles, but if you look at it, you know who's on the Raw roster, right? Who was a former Bullet Club member? Finn Balor.
Finn Balor.
They can have Balor join in with them.
And that would be fantastic. That would be the dynamic that would set off the next Nexus, per se, right?
Just the one team I wanted to see succeed.
Well, you know, I mean, here's the thing. Like I told you, the WWE, and this is the writer's fault. I'm going to give it 100% on the writer's shoulders because they don't understand what to do with good talent. You see, when you have clubs like this, when you have people like the Four Horsemen, you have people, you know, like just this massive group.
NWO.
You know, I hate mentioning the NWO because I hate when I think of NWO, I think of what it was at the very end of WCW, where everybody and their mother was a member of NWO. It was ridiculous, you know. And then you had the LWO, the Latino World Order. You had all it was
kind of like also as well with TNA when they had the Aces and Eights thing.
It kind of
fell
into
the NWO.
That was good until they started unmasking everybody. It was really good because that's the thing. You want to see one dominant group. And this is really important for the dynamic of wrestling. You need to have, and you saw it with you know, like NWA and everything like that. You had Ric Flair and the Four Horsemen. You had these people that were dominating on the mic, owning all the belts, basically saying, we run this spot here. You know, and with the Nexus, you know, we're like, hey, we're the young crew. We're going to come in here and disrupt your matches. We don't give a shit because it's our time. Mm-hmm. That's what needs to happen. That's why I want to see Luke Gallows and Carl Anderson retain their championship belts. Let's start off because remember, this is a clean slate. This is the end of the season for WWE. This is supposed to be the wrap up. This is the season finale. Let's start the new season with this tension, with this group, because it needs to form.
Then again, it's a long shot because the things that are like the small way to go, WWE never takes that route.
Yeah, and so if we know ass backwards WWE, what's going to happen is you're going to have Cesaro and Sheamus win the titles back. No. I'm telling you, this is the ass backwards thing of WWE. These are the writers going, oh my god, this is a great idea. You know, let's give Sheamus and Cesaro another chance. And
the James Bond group. Have you seen their entrances recently?
Yes. You know, Cesaro. It's I don't know. The guy was born a stripper. I think that's the thing. He was meant to rip off his clothes. And don't get me wrong. I think he looks awesome.
He's a good wrestler.
Oh, he's a great wrestler. And I don't know why they tagged him up. He has the potential to go off on his own.
Yeah.
You know that
heck, even world title.
That crazy ass uppercut that he does. I mean, I fell in love with it from the moment I saw it, but they took it away.
It's beautiful. Well, he did pull it out recently in, I forgot what match it was, but it was recent. I don't think it was a Raw. Maybe it was. But he did do the, you know, he lifted up the wrestler and did the uppercut.
Which is fantastic. It's the European uppercut.
Yeah.
That's what it was called before. And his modified version of it. And you know, like I said, I want to kind of see him retain the belt. Now, with that said, okay, John Cena and Nikki Bella versus The Miz and
Maurice.
Yeah.
The girl who knows many hand motions.
Well, that's perfect, because when you're in Orlando and you know, you're with a Latin crowd, and I can say this because I'm Hispanic, we use a lot of big hand signs and languages and stuff. But, jeez.
You know what I heard that they might do? I heard this from another a podcaster. I believe it was Good Mic Work, giving him a plug.
There you go.
That they might do the Macho Man and Elizabeth thing, kind of, sort of, with Cena and Nikki Bella, and have Cena propose in the middle of the ring, you know, to Nikki, which it might be interesting. I mean, hey, add another moment to WrestleMania's history.
Yeah, but I mean, it's been done before. I mean, the most interesting marriage angle besides Macho Man was those Triple H and Stephanie. Well, Triple H and Test.
Drive-through.
Triple H and Test. There's no better way to ruin a wedding than to show, hey, I already married your wife and she was passed out, because that's perfectly cool in the social world. So John Cena versus The Miz and their side women. What's your prediction here for this?
Well, definitely Cena and Nikki. I don't think Miz and Maurice are going to get the win in this one. But one thing I do like that they're doing with this build-up is I heard that in one of the SmackDown promos that Miz was cutting, he mentioned the whole WrestleMania 27 fiasco he had with Cena. Do you remember that? Whole... First, it ended in a count out, and then The Rock came out and said, no, we're restarting this match, and then Miz got the 1-2-3 and stuff like that. He mentioned that. I don't remember in what way or how, but he did mention that whole run,
and
which I kind of liked.
And you talk about interesting kick-out moments like that, because we've seen those happen. That's a common... big surprise move with wrestling. We've seen it done with Hulk Hogan when he didn't want to win clean. You know, where they went ahead and was it the Papa Shango fiasco?
Oh yeah, and the Ultimate Warrior.
Yeah. I mean, I'm just saying that we've seen the whole kind of false start and kind of holding the grudge thing before. So I honestly don't know. First of all, I know that John Cena is probably not going to put over The Miz. I'm going to go ahead and kind of hold this for later, because I have something to kind of... I'm going to put a little pinprick in this one, because I have something to say about the Undertaker match.
That's going to be a fun one to get to.
Okay, I think John Cena, he's not ready to leave yet. I think John Cena is still hanging around, and
but he's in the early stages. He's like that. What was it? The 03 Rock. Whenever he started his movie career, but he was still around.
He was still around, still kind of showing up and doing the big shows, and kind of he's basically what's going to happen to Cena is he's going to go the route of a Brock Lesnar, where we're going to see him showing up for big moments and to take on, you know. But the thing is, what he doesn't do is he doesn't put over the young talent. You know, he doesn't... It's very rare And people say it's very rare when you get a clean with Bray Wyatt. Yeah, and that's and the thing is that wasn't clean though. You know, I mean, it kind of was. I mean, I'm going to give it to Bray because I love Bray. All right, it's just he doesn't seem to put over anybody super clean. You know?
Yeah, it's always. I think the only notable one that he put over clean was Daniel Bryan.
Yeah. And
but then again, I think there was something in that storyline that Cena had like a messed up arm.
He had something messed up. He came out of the ring. He said, well, you know, he's not supposed to be wrestling, blah, blah, blah. So, I mean, he always has a stipulation where, you know, he'll kind of get by. And that's the thing. I don't think he's ready to push over The Miz, even though The Miz is doing a great job. You know?
Miz might not be good as a wrestler, but as just a talker, he's amazing. Great.
Yeah, and the thing is, you know, the other person that was like that is Hulk Hogan. Hulk Hogan may not be the greatest in-ring skill, you know, but, I mean, the guy could talk. Mm. And the guy could spin circles around somebody, you know what I mean, brother? You know, he took a lot of vitamins. A lot of vitamins. So we're going to say John Cena for that one. Now, we got
Styles versus Shane McMahon.
I don't know why this is happening. Look, I think Shane McMahon is a glutton for punishment. Because obviously Shane's gonna lose.
Yeah, and it's. I mean, I didn't mind him coming back for that Hell in a Cell match last year, even though it was really strange and odd.
It was a weird workup to it. I don't understand. I think that. Shane's at that point where he's getting to an age where he's like, no, I'm still young. And then maybe this is his midlife crisis. but Shane still wants to be part of this thing. So I don't understand what he's going to do with AJ Styles. I think AJ Styles has the power to, cause Shane, when he needs to, man, he digs deep and he pulls it out. Shane has my respect for that because Shane has always put his best foot forward for the company and his body. He's put his body through so much shit.
Yeah, he's always had his spots. Like, I wonder what spot this might have.
Exactly. And, I mean, just because he's taking on AJ Styles, I mean, it leads to a whole, like, series of opportunities because AJ Styles is in the prime. Even though he's an older wrestler, he's still in the prime of his physique where he's just getting started in the WWE, but he has so much more to give us.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's like he. I was gonna say he's like an Asian wrestler, where it doesn't matter how old he gets, he still looks really good. And I know that's terrible, but look at New Japan, look at some of the older wrestlers that are there, and they could still hang with the young boys like it's nothing. Exactly. AJ Styles is that way, you know.
And one interesting thing about this feud is, did you see what happened with SmackDown this past Friday? Right, that. Yeah. No, not Friday. Oh, Tuesday. I'm still on the mindset on Friday.
It's not on Friday anymore. It's on Tuesday. Oops,
it's live.
Live, yeah, because we couldn't hold all the internet spoilers, so we had to move it to five. Not like he has a company to fight against. It's not like somebody's going to come out and say the whole spoil the whole
Eric Bischoff.
Doing Eric Bischoff on the shit.
AJ kind of had like a backstage brawl with Shane and he threw him into like a car window, which I was like, whoa, Vince allowed that?
Well, I'm pretty sure it was kind of a candy glass moment, what they call the candy glass moment when they kind of set it up and it's not real glass.
Yeah.
But I like the fact that he does this stuff because Shane, and that's the thing, sometimes I don't understand why the McMahons kind of put themselves through this. I think it's because people like to see that, but I think people enjoy Shane, because he comes out with all this hype and he comes out with...
Yeah, he has like the energy and like the charismatic mm-hmm. in him. He has that walk, you know, whenever he does the, you know, here comes the money and those $1 million shoes.
And that's the thing, I think, and they said it, and I think What Culture Wrestling said it best when they said, you know, the reason that they bring back a lot of these people, the reason that they go ahead and bring back the legends and do all this other stuff, and maybe the reason probably Shane McMahon is there again, is because, you know, the wrestling fans, the older generation, wants to feel like they understand what's going on. They want to feel like they belong. So when they hear Shane's music pop out, you know, they get nostalgic. They think, oh, Attitude Era. They think all this other stuff. It's they recognize and it's more familiar to them. And so whenever you see that, you can get comfortable. It's like, getting into a really comfortable pair of jeans. You know, something that's stretched out, it's perfect for you. You might not wear them to like a club if that's what people do. I have no clue. I'm old as shit. It's the type of thing where you feel comfortable because you know this and you get excited for it. Mm-hmm. And I think that's what this is. I think that AJ Styles is definitely going to win. I think Shane's going to get the shit beat out of him in front of his family again.
And what I'm... I hope Randy Orton's on ringside to tell them everything's okay.
Yeah, I know.
I hope. Because I don't think they've confirmed it yet. I hope it's like a no disqualification, just street fight, just...
Yeah, there's no stipulation just yet, and I wouldn't be surprised if that came out.
Have Shane do the West Coast to Coast with the trash can on Styles. Oh, I would man. Love to see that.
And I think AJ Styles would take that without a problem. I think he'd love it, actually.
Yeah, I think he would have it as an honor. I bet he would take the trash can home and like have Shane sign it. Hey, I took the Coast to Coast.
So, I mean, you know, like I said, this is going to be an interesting match. I think it's going to be a fun match. It's the type of match that, you know, during John Cena, go ahead and go get another drink. Or, you know, go use the bathroom again and then come back and be ready to kind of get your woo on, you know, for AJ Styles and Shane McMahon, with AJ Styles kind of, you know, taking this one. Then we have the United States Championship. It's Chris Jericho versus Kevin Owens.
The bromance that died. Every fan and their mother are all crying about this, including me.
Yeah, well, you know, because they had a really good thing going. I think that...
They were friendship goals, I mean...
Exactly. And you know, when you were building when Jericho was building his list and kind of getting everything together, I mean, you kind of knew where this was going. You kind of had an idea of what you were going to see.
Yeah.
But Kevin Owens, personally, I loved him as champion. I think he has tremendous potential. And I think that the management, the backstage WWE doesn't see it. When he was it Kevin Steen?
Yeah, Kevin Steen. Kill Steen, kill.
Yep. When he not only proved that he could hold a championship, he not only proved that he could be the best in his league for being a big man, but he has the mic skills. When he goes on guest commentary, that's the only time that I would say I love to listen to this.
He even predicted this guy, Todd Phillips or whatever, the guy who recently got busted for all those sex messages. He predicted it in advance in this little, I think it was like a pre-show thing that they did. He like looks over at his like iPad and he's like, I just saw your password. It was 6969. Disgusting.
and you know what? That's the thing. I think with Kevin Owens, I think he has everything to be the perfect heel, because people love to see him. And then Jericho's the same way.
Yeah.
Jericho, ever since he premiered, even though he could play a face, he plays a better heel.
I always see Jericho as the heel, especially whenever he had, I think he has one of the best feuds of the PG era, which was him and Punk. Mm-hmm. When they had that 2012 feud going into WrestleMania 28. Yeah, 28. The one in Miami.
Yeah.
He had Jericho brought in CM Punk's straight edge thing and how, you know, he doesn't believe in that. But yet again, his family has a history with it. So Jericho used that and played mind games with Punk. And I thought it was a fantastic feud. It was crazy.
And the best part about it is whether you like him or not, Chris Jericho will always be a good guy. Because not only does he care about, you know, the in-ring talent that he's working with, but he's also respectful in that sense. Mm-hmm. And I mean, this is, you know, putting kayfabe aside, he's always been like that. And the thing is, I think he knows what wrestling really means, as far as being able to work the road, being able to go ahead and give people what they want. And I mean, he was severely underappreciated in WCW. Yes. And then when he came over, a lot of people forget the fact that, I mean, he was the first undisputed champion. Mm-hmm. He had some of the most magnificent matches with Chris Benoit. which Chris Benoit was an amazing wrestler, and I know that, you know, a lot of people don't like to talk about him because of what he did, but yeah, you know what?
And it's forgotten. I mean, it's Triple H versus Shawn Michaels versus blank at WrestleMania 20.
And you know, and here's the thing. I understand whatever he did was horrible, and I understand that, you know, these things happen, but at the same time, you can't erase certain parts of history. You can't erase certain things like this. And Chris Jericho has always proven himself time and time again.
One of the best matches, even though he got the crap beat out of him in that match, was him versus Triple H and the Hell in the Cell.
Mm-hmm.
That was an awesome match.
And so you know that Chris Jericho is going to come into this 110%, because I think he's going to start a tour with Fozzy again.
Mm-hmm. But I recently heard that he did sign, I believe, for Extreme Rules. So they're going to keep him around a little bit longer, maybe a rematch against Owens.
Which, I mean, here's the thing. With rematches and everything else, as much as I'd like to see it, I want to see them move forward. And,
yeah.
And the thing is, I think that Kevin Owens is going to take this. I think that,
definitely. Yeah.
I think that he's got this. Only reason why is because Chris Jericho knows how to put somebody over. Chris Jericho has other things in mind, and Chris Jericho will drop the belt to Kevin Owens because of the fact that they are no longer going to push Kevin for the world title. Yeah. And I mean, that sucks. For me, that breaks my heart because I think that he's going to be underutilized, and I'm hoping that, you know, he brings prestige to the United States champion. I hope they put that belt around his waist.
Yeah, keep it on him
for a good year. Get him started in a really good feud. You know, most likely, and I don't know why I say this, but I think it might be like a Kevin Owens, maybe AJ Styles feud for a bit. And this is where your Finn Balor thing comes in.
If they have Styles jump over the Raw.
Because here's the thing. If they have him jump over. Because, like I said, it all depends on what they're going to do. Because if they're going to go ahead and build that team, mm-hmm. right, he needs to stay on SmackDown. If not, AJ Styles, I think, needs to move to Raw. And I don't know if because here's what I'd like to see. I'd like to see AJ Styles get that extreme push, but I think he would work amazingly with Kevin Owens. I think that you'd put those guys together and it'd be just magic. Mm-hmm. And you could either kind of turn him face, you know, because, I mean, people love him anyway.
Yeah, he will have the crowd no matter what.
Exactly.
Heel or face.
This is where I'm talking about, like, as far as what they would do with him. Because, you know, if they're going to go ahead and keep the club, just the club, and not bring in the other people, they need to kind of figure out what they're going to do with him. Because right now, he's like a floating heel, you know? But he's like a rock heel, you know? He's like the one that's kind of floating there that everybody loves, and they love his theme music, they love his opening, he plays to the crowd, but yet he's a bad guy. Mm-hmm. So they need to figure out what they're going to do with him, and because if not, he's going to get lost, you know? So Kevin Owens to win the United States Championship, I think Chris Jericho is going to lay down. Do you think it's going to be clean?
It's a long shot. It's a long shot. We don't know. Maybe. I mean, yeah, I would like to see that, but by knowing Owens, maybe he'll pull something out. Maybe he'll do that apron powerbomb thing that he does and just bring Jericho back into the ring or something.
It'd be interesting to see because, like I said, there's a lot of heat on it, especially after the Fastlane Goldberg squash match. God, I hate that thing.
Yeah.
And you guys heard me gripe about this on the last podcast. I absolutely hate it because, you know, the whole thing with me, and I'll get to this when we get to, you know, the championship match, but I don't believe in squash matches. It's squash matches. I really don't. I think they're the biggest bullshit you could pull on people because just the dominance that you're showing by one wrestler and then to put him in a pay-per-view and then have him go 20 or 30 minutes with another wrestler,
mm-hmm.
it's so like, what?
And the worst part about it is that was the main event for Fastlane.
Yeah.
Imagine the people who paid money to sit in an arena just to see a 2-minute main event.
You know, and the thing is, I knew they were going to go ahead and drop the belt. I knew it was going to happen.
There was no doubt. I mean, But I never saw Owens coming out of that.
It shouldn't have been like that. It should have been something where what would have been fantastic, and this is the way I would have booked it. If Kevin Owens started the match, they started going at it, Chris Jericho came to the ring, right? And then tried to help him by, like, you know, trying to smack Goldberg with a chair or some shit and hit Kevin Owens instead.
Yeah.
I think that would have led great fuel, and that would have shown that Kevin Owens, because remember how we were talking about finishers, how everybody kicks out of finishers?
Yeah.
Right? Kevin Owens has kicked out of a lot of finishers. Kevin Owens, they show his power.
He's the only man who's, like, survived the John Cena onslaught.
Yes. Yes. And so, you know, when you put him against the lumberjack, you know, the freaking slam that this guy Goldberg does. And, you know, it was a two-parter. Took his breath away, picked him up, slam, done.
Yeah.
If you would have had him lose because of Jericho, you know, screwing with him and, you know, him taking that thing, you know, like taking a chair shot and then doing that, it'll show him that he was at an even weaker state. But no, it kind of puts him with everybody else who took the same exact spear.
The Brock Lesnar.
Exactly. And we're gonna get to that match in just a second, but I'm just saying, finishers are not what they used to be, but I am definitely hoping that Kevin Owens gets that championship, that they do something brilliant with him. Now, we're gonna go ahead and go into The Undertaker versus Roman Reigns.
Yeah, I was gonna tell you, you should say that, because if I would have said that match, I think I would have puked.
And you know, here's the thing, and remember how I told you, I'm going to take that pin, I'm going to pull it out right now, because this is something critical, something crucial that everybody knows about The Undertaker. The Undertaker is old school. The Undertaker is old school. The Undertaker understands that he's going out. The Undertaker understands that he didn't want the streak to go on as long as it did, but it did. The Undertaker is all about putting over the young talent.
Yes.
Which scares the living shit out of me. Because what I'm thinking we're going to see...
Is Roman
beating The Undertaker.
And what burns the wounds even more about this is, you know, originally they were going with the plans of Cena versus Taker. Mm-hmm. But I think it was Vince himself who was just like, no, put Roman in the match.
And you see, and that's the thing. Look. According to rumors, and I talked about this in the last podcast, according to rumors, WrestleMania 34 is going to see what they want to book is Brock Lesnar
versus
Roman Reigns for the Undisputed Championship, or the Universal Championship, I'm sorry. The Universal Championship. Which, that to me tells me two things. Either A, they're going to have the frickin' belt fumble around like crazy, which... I don't know. I don't think they're going to do
it. I don't see it like that. What I see is probably Brock keeping that belt for that long. I can see WWE pulling that stunt off, which is going to suck, because then that means we're not going to see the belt as often.
And he's at the end of his 3-year contract, so I mean, it would take him all the way into WrestleMania, which means that he'd have limited shows as champion. But I think if they do that, what's going to happen, and remember how I told you about that whole crap about squash matches and then seeing this. What's going to happen is Brock's going to go into the Goldberg match, and they're going to duke it out for 15-20 minutes, and then he's going to beat Goldberg.
You really think they're going to keep it for 15 minutes?
Well,
I can see the opposite of the Goldberg squash and have Brock squash Goldberg.
You see, that's the thing. I don't think they would do that. Because Goldberg is probably trying to play the card that he's not the weaker man. So he's going to survive in there with him for that long. But something is going to happen. Heyman's going to get involved. Something is going to happen.
Brock Lesnar just starts screaming on the mic.
That's what I'm saying. Goldberg. That's what I'm saying. And you see, that's the thing. I honestly think that he's going to go ahead and win the belt from Goldberg. And then he's going to keep it all the way to next WrestleMania.
Yep.
And what I think is going to happen here is that, you know, he'll have the occasional match with whatever. I don't know what the hell they're going to do with Goldberg.
Probably he's just going to go, because I think his contract only went for that long.
His contract only went for a couple matches, but the thing is, I think they extended his contract. I'm not 100% sure, but that's something that we had to look up. But still, I think that what they did is they extended his contract. So
what I think they might do, this is a long shot, but maybe they're not going to have him wrestle, but probably next year for the Hall of Fame, he's going to be the headliner.
And it could be that.
I could see them pulling that stunt off unless Taker, this is his final match, which I hope not. And Taker
And that's what I'm saying. Yeah. Taker is going to be going out the door. Taker's hurting pretty bad, and Taker is, I mean, he's up there where he can now just kind of relax. He's done his dues. He's you know, longest running consecutive WrestleMania appearances. I mean, the guy's been around forever. He's got the loyalty of the back, and plus the love of Vince McMahon,
which is the best thing to have.
Well, yeah, but I mean, the thing is with him is that he has this this compassion with the crowd, and well, not with the crowd, but with the sport. Compassion with the sport, where he understands that he has to lay down for the younger talent. He understands that he's got to be there to push the other guy over. When you're going out the door, that's what you do. I mean, that's his Bible. It's the Undertaker's Bible, you know?
And the thing that's really scary about this, it's going to be Roman.
And that's the thing. I don't want to see that happen just because, okay? Just because I think that Roman Reigns still needs more development.
Yeah, like, Roman's not a bad wrestler. Most people absolutely shit on him, like, to the point that it's like, oh, even his moves are bad. No, he's not the worst wrestler on the planet. I've seen worse. Braun Strowman.
Oh. It sounds like you got a shitty cough.
But Roman still needs work. You know, like, one thing I've heard, I forgot who I heard it from, but they said it best. Roman has the spot moves, the power moves, the big moves that get the crowd standing, but he doesn't have the filler moves. Like, you know, your headlocks,
yeah,
your arm locks.
With your transitions. He doesn't have your transitions in. And I think this is where I'm talking about the development stage. I think he needs to go back. I think he needs to take some time and work on his mic skills. That's number one. And then number two, he needs to work on his short game. Like, basically, you know, like, the transitions, you know, going into the headlocks, the arm drags, the stuff like that. The stuff that says, hey, I'm not just a big guy, but I can do these little solid things in the side. This is what John Cena has. John Cena can do that. John Cena can hang for a bit. As much as you hate the dude, right, you got to give it out to John Cena, because, I mean, he started off.
He's hanging in, though, all these, with so many different names, from The Rock to Wade Barrett. You can just, he has like two lists filled with just names that of wrestlers that he's gone up against.
Yeah, and many wrestlers that he's buried too. But here's the that's the thing.
A graveyard filled of wrestlers.
And that's the thing. Look, this is why everybody hates John Cena, because he does bury wrestlers. Okay, and I think that's,
I think he makes Triple H jealous with how many wrestlers.
Well, I mean, even Triple H knew when to go ahead and relinquish certain things. That's why Triple H is Triple H, because he understood when he had to lose. He understood when he had to kind of give it up a little bit. John Cena, I think he's a great wrestler. He's a great micsman. Always has been.
Yeah.
Ever since he premiered,
he can hang in there with the mic.
Exactly. Yeah. I just think that he's hated because of the power that he has. And Roman Reigns, I think he's hated because of the power that he's given. Not because of the power, because I don't think Roman Reigns understands the power that he has, because he doesn't understand exactly what management wants from him.
I mean, a good example of that, like you said, with the power, recently he got suspended for like a whole month because of, I think it was like a drug or whatever.
Yeah, the wellness policy.
And he's still on this high note. I mean, when was the last time you've heard a wrestler be on that high note, you know, after getting suspended for that long?
Yeah, because didn't he apologize? And, you know, he said to my fans.
Yeah, he apologized.
And that's the thing. I think that Roman gets a lot of bad rep, and he gets crushed on a lot because of the fact that he lacks some of the skills that's needed. And the thing is, I think what makes it worse is the fact that they compare him, you know, all the time to The Rock and all these things. And so they compare him to all these great wrestlers with amazing mic skills that he doesn't have.
Yeah.
So it's like saying, well, look at this apple. This apple's amazing. You know, this apple's amazing because it's like an orange. No, it's not, dude. You know, what world do you come from? But when, like, when he worked with a shield, and when, I mean, he was your quintessential big guy.
Yeah, he was the powerhouse of the shield.
The powerhouse, exactly. And I think that with some development, Roman could do amazing things. I mean, because John Cena, like you said, he's slowly creeping out the door. You need somebody to replace him. And they said, well, you know, we're going to go ahead and try to push Roman. But they've been pushing Roman so far down our throats that, you know, it's made us kind of sick of him. And the fact that I think The Undertaker is going to lay down for Roman.
Which is absolutely scary, just the thought of it. Just imagine that crowd.
The crowd's gonna, the yeah, crowd is gonna, totally gonna turn. It's gonna riot.
But here's the way, if, now hear me out on this, but this is something that I thought up recently. What if, because recently Roman has been showing, you know, some signs of being a heel. A promo he cut, I believe it was last Monday on Raw, he's like, I'm going to retire The Undertaker. But he said it in such a tone, you know, yeah, like, I'm gonna end this guy. You know, just put him in the back like old Yeller. What if they have Roman go in this as a heel, and then maybe for a short period of time have him work as a heel? Be like, oh, I beat The Undertaker. I beat your legend. Now I'm the legend, you know.
Like a legend killer kind of thing, like Randy Orton did?
Kind
of. I mean, I can see it. The thing is, like I told you, what I think, what Roman needs is a good manager. Roman needs someone who could talk for him. Just like Yokozuna, right? You had Mr. Fuji. The Mr. Fuji could barely talk.
But he still delivered the message.
And then you had Jim Cornette also doing the exact same thing. This is what Roman needs.
Bobby Heenan.
Yeah, this is what Roman needs. Roman needs somebody to step up and talk for him.
And maybe what they can do, thinking about this, maybe they can put him with Paul Heyman. And have that, him and Heyman and Lesnar all working together. And then maybe Roman kind of turns on Lesnar, setting up the WrestleMania.
That would be a powerhouse. I would get behind that. Because of the fact that here's two men that are completely unstoppable. And the thing is, we don't have to listen to Roman talk. Roman could just be the presence in the background. Just like Brock. You know, Brock can talk, but Brock,
he's the presence in the background.
He's the presence. He's the one who's huffing and puffing, going side to side. and Paul Heyman's there getting all red in the face. And let Paul Heyman do what he does best, which is he talks. He loves to talk. So Paul Heyman could go in there and turn Roman into like this amazing, you know, freaking monster. Because that's what Roman, you know, Roman can be with the right person in front of him. This is why managers exist, WWE. The reason they exist is to push over talent that you can't push over on their own. So we're going to go ahead and go with Roman Reigns defeating The Undertaker, which is something we don't want to see, but I'm going to call it as I see it. I think The Undertaker is going to lay down for him. I think it's going to be a very emotional moment.
Yeah, I
think they're going to go ahead and kind of he's probably going to get on the mic and say something.
So, Taker's going to have two losses at WrestleMania.
Which isn't bad. Yeah. It's not bad.
It's not bad, but it's interesting. Definitely. Yeah.
Well, like I said, every good legend has to go out, and we'll probably, you know, see that happen at this WrestleMania. Now, Raw's Women's Championship. We got Bayley versus Charlotte Flair versus Sasha Banks. Now, this is Bayley's big WrestleMania debut. Bayley is currently going in as a champion. Charlotte, as you say, she's ugly as balls and everything else, but you know what? I love her as a champion. I think this would create a decent story. I mean, we've seen Charlotte as champion for a long time. We know what she can hold.
She used to have that pay-per-view winning streak until it got destroyed at Fastlane by Bayley.
Yeah. Which is interesting because, you know, are they going to give her back the title? Because, like I said, there's a really good dynamic there. I like the way Charlotte works. Charlotte is very quick. She's conniving. And she plays to the crowd, something her father was great with. And that's why I think she would be great to continue the legacy forward. Holding that title for her, it feels right on her waist. So I think that Bailey's going to go ahead and give this up because Sasha Banks is also was also a good because she was champion not that long ago, right? But it was like the Divas champion, right?
It was
before it was
with women's because Divas the last one was at WrestleMania 32.
Okay.
So yeah, she was Raw Women's Champion at one point, but it was Hell in a Cell, I think. I want to say, don't quote me on it, but.
Yeah, well, I mean, we all make mistakes. But still, I honestly think that Charlotte's going to go ahead and take this one.
And what's interesting is also as well that Dana Brooke is kind of like a lackey to Charlotte recently. I wonder how she's going to work out with this match.
Well, I mean, are we going to see her helping her? You know, are we going to go ahead and see that you know, the typical heel victory where, you know, someone gets involved and you know, gets beyond that. I don't know.
Well, maybe Dana getting involved.
Exactly. So, I mean, that's something to look out for. I honestly think that Charlotte's going to go ahead and take this one.
Yeah, and this one is probably going to be, I can see it happening, maybe other than Jericho and Owens, this might be match of the night. Because these women can pull off
a good show.
Like Fastlane. It was an awesome match. And in Royal Rumble, too, that spot that was it Bayley that took it? The apron?
Yeah.
Yeah, that move that Charlotte does, I don't know what it's actually called, to Bayley on the apron was amazing. That was like the move of the night for me.
And so, you have a lot of really good young talent that has recently come up, and this is their grand stage. Mm-hmm. So this is where you pull out all the stops. This is where you say that I'm going to go ahead and make this be something more than what it is.
Yeah.
So, you know, I definitely agree with you. I think this is going to be a great match. And then we're going to move into the WWE Championship, Bray Wyatt versus Randy Orton. Bray Wyatt coming in as champion, which is something that I never thought I would see.
And another thing I never thought I would see is Austin in the WWE storyline.
Yeah,
Randy Orton burning down.
Well, you know, you know what? I'll be honest with you. This is like the weirdest thing, but for some reason, Randy Orton reminds me of like a Brian Pillman.
That's an interesting comparison.
It is, but I'm saying that in the case that, you know, it's like Randy Orton has had so many weird demons. You know, he's had, and I know they tried to kind of like hype them up more than usual with all the ridiculous crap that they put him through with the wafer, you know, the Wyatt family kind of thing where they made his eyes glow or all this bullshit. But, you know, Randy Orton is that kind of crazy.
Yeah, and he hears voices in his head, just like the theme song states.
So what do you think here? I mean, I think Bray Wyatt is a good wrestler. I really want to see him retain the championship, but do you think they're going to give the championship back over to Orton?
It's a long shot as well for me. Like, I don't know exactly who is it going to go to, and you also have Luke Harper. I don't know if he's going to get involved. I know it's not going to be turned into a triple threat match because they already basically stated that he's not going to have a big WrestleMania moment, but he might factor in the match some way, shape, or form.
So here's an interesting factor. Now that you mention that, because I actually agree with you, I think that Luke Harper is going to get somehow involved in this. What side is he going to take? I mean, is he going to go ahead and kind of screw over Orton, or is he going to go ahead and screw over Bray?
Maybe screw over both. I don't know. Just mess up the match as a whole.
Somebody's going to lose the belt. I mean, unless it's a disqualification, which would be really weird.
Especially in a WrestleMania stage, I can't see it happening.
And I mean, that's, like I said, I honestly think that's going to be really weird. But I don't know.
I wouldn't want to see Bray Wyatt drop the belt.
Neither would I, because I think he can do some amazing things. I think Bray Wyatt can, if they bring back that weird factor, because to me, Bray Wyatt seems like the next Undertaker. He seems like the kind of powerhouse that could hold that. If he hadn't been potatoed for so freaking long.
Thank you to John Cena.
Yeah. I mean, well, I'm just saying, I mean, it's stating the obvious.
It was like after he had that match at 30 with Cena, he just went into that downhill spiral.
Well, and it didn't help that he had all the what is it, his Nexus character.
Oh, yeah, that's right. The Husky Harris.
Husky Harris chance. That didn't help at the very beginning, because the thing is, eventually we gained enough respect for Bray Wyatt where the Husky Harris chance stopped. And then John Cena squashed him. And then it's like, it was like a losing field for him. Where he was put in match after match for him to job to other people, which it sucked, because now his credibility as a champion is...
It's kind of low.
Yeah, it's kind of low. But the thing is, he has a lot of potential to do great things. And yeah, Orton, I don't know, man. I don't know. I'm tired of seeing Orton with a belt. I mean, I really am. Just because, I mean, he's a great wrestler.
He's not a bad wrestler. I don't mind watching his matches,
but I mean,
it would be interesting to have him with another title run.
And that's the thing. His title runs to me were his matches were good, but his title run is a little lackluster.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm saying I don't get behind him. I don't see anything where I'm like, hey, I have to see him wrestle tonight. I have to see him defend the title.
And to be honest, I can't remember many of Orton's title runs except him with Christian, because those were good matches. But other than that, I can't.
Yeah, Chris. You know, and that's the thing. Christian always knew how to kind of deal with him, because, I mean, Christian was always a really good worker. He was a good in-ring worker. Talk about somebody who was really... kind of put to the wayside after he broke off from Edge and Christian. I mean,
well, those rumors that he might be inducted into the Hall of Fame this year, that he might be the final inductee to be announced.
It'd be interesting because
you always have the head Carter announced first, and then you have your other guys, and then you have another big name
in last. It would be interesting to see Edge induct Christian into the Hall of Fame.
Oh, definitely.
I think that would be because recently it was announced that Teddy Long was going to be inducted by the APA.
And Kurt Angle will be inducted by John Cena.
Exactly. So, I mean, we're seeing all these things.
And what's kind of funny is Edge's wife, Beth Phoenix, is also getting inducted. So, he's going to have to make a choice. Wife or best friend?
And, you know, and here's the thing. I'll be honest with you about this whole thing. I think that Beth Phoenix is being inducted way too early. I think that there's other women that should have been inducted first. I think Ivory.
China.
Well,
I'm on that China train.
Hey, you know what? I agree with you 110%. I think she paved the way for women wrestlers. Not only was she fantastic, but it's never going to happen. Yeah. They're never going to allow it to happen.
Triple H even stated it, even though he made the dumbest excuse on why he didn't want it.
I know, and I hate it. You know, but I'm being realistic. You know, I mean, I would have tossed the name out first also, but I'm being realistic here as far as what kind of person would be inducted into this kind of championship. And, you know, I think Ivory held she did a great run. She went up against some of the greatest wrestlers. Not only that, but she really held her own.
Mm-hmm.
And it's sad that she hasn't been inducted yet.
You want to know who's won? I'm not sure if he's not... has been inducted yet, but I hope they at least induct him this year, because his time is coming up very soon. He even announced it himself. It was Vader.
Yeah, and you see, and Vader was another great wrestler. Vader, and I mean, yeah, he hasn't been doing good with health. He was one of the big men, and he pushed him really hard
in WWE. But I think his WCW run will be the thing to talk about the most.
Oh, no, absolutely, because I think he got to a point, and from what I heard, I mean, he was difficult to work with as far as, you know, backstage politics goes, so I think that's what's really kind of held him back a lot.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, it's still yet to be seen.
Yeah.
So...
he's another one I'm hoping to at least get inducted. Him and Christian will probably be the last two in... For celebrity, who would you want to be for the celebrity ring this year?
You know, and that's hard. We were talking about because I was looking at different things, and I was thinking, you know, Lawrence Taylor. Lawrence Taylor, he fought Bam Bam Bigelow.
Yeah.
He got a clean win over Bam Bam Bigelow, which, I mean, he was a football linebacker. He was considered a celebrity, and he's like the only celebrity that can legitimately say that he, even though Bam Bam Bigelow carried him, Mm-hmm. Which Bam Bam Bigelow hasn't been indicted. He hasn't been inducted into the Hall of Fame either.
I'm not sure.
No, he hasn't. Which is a crime. But Lawrence Taylor, because you have the Refrigerator Perry, who was in there, and he did the whole Royal Rumble thing. But that's one thing that it doesn't like click with me is the fact that they haven't inducted him because of the fact that he was at a WrestleMania, he won in a singles competition, mm-hmm. so he actually. You know, was in a match, and he was victorious.
And wasn't he the main event as well for that?
Yeah, he was. Yeah. Because it was a big feud. So as far as going with celebrity inductee, he should be the one. Because he hasn't been inducted yet. He had a really great match. Even though, I said, Bam Bam Bigelow carried him mm-hmm. through that match. You know, because Bam Bam Bigelow knew exactly what he had to do. So
what's funny is I have an opposite on who I want to see inducted for the celebrity wing, even though he kind of got a little bit like left behind last year and got Snoop Dogg got inducted out of all people. I would love to see the lead singer of Motorhead,
Lemmy. Yeah.
Yeah. Lemmy get inducted. I mean, he's played a crucial role in the wrestling world, even though he wasn't a wrestler or anything. I mean, heck, he's.
Well, I mean, and he made an appearance doing, you know, opening up for Triple H. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, that would be brilliant, considering that he passed last year. And it'd be interesting to see
Triple H induct him.
Exactly.
That'd be such a moment.
That would be really cool. I could see that happening. But, like I said, I really don't know. Now, we were talking also about Seth Rollins versus Triple H.
Yeah.
Seth Rollins versus Triple H, bringing Triple H into this. This is the match that we thought we were going to see, that we might not see, that may happen, may not happen.
It's a long shot, but I think it's going to happen now.
All right. So with that being said, who do you think is going to win this one?
There are so many factors to be looked at in this match. I mean, you have Samoa Joe. Okay. Kind of as Triple H's little lackey from NXT. They will kind of, at first they build him up as that. Now they haven't really mentioned him and Triple H together in a while. Because mm-hmm. Samoa Joe's doing his own thing with Sami Zayn right now.
Yeah.
And you also have Mick Foley. This past Monday night, something happened between him and Stephanie and Triple H. I don't know exactly what it was because I don't really follow up on those storylines. And Mick Foley brought out Mr. Socko and gave it to Triple H.
And you know, it should be interesting to see because I think, I don't know if you think Triple H will lay down for Seth Rollins?
Maybe.
I mean,
it would be interesting is Seth Rollins giving Triple H a pedigree.
That would be interesting.
Triple H eating his own move for once.
Well, I mean, he has before. You know, when The Rock did it to him. So it'd be interesting because the thing is Triple H is such a powerhouse and Seth Rollins is such a, I don't want to say he's a little man, but
he's like a technician high flyer.
Yeah. He's got a light body. Him, yeah. Exactly. He's got a light body. So the thing is, it'd be interesting to see him kind of run around. Cause, the last time we saw Triple H, you know, in WrestleMania was
against Roman in the
against
main event.
Roman, and you know, it's like he's working his way through Shield members. But
that's true. He hit Ambrose in Roadblock.
Uh-huh.
He hit Roman, of course, WrestleMania, and now it's Rollins' turn.
Exactly.
Which it's going to be interesting because Triple H picked Rollins at the beginning, and it was the whole reason on why the Shield fell apart.
Exactly.
Which I'm surprised. I don't think they mentioned that in the storyline as of yet.
Well, I think, because, you know, every once in a while you got WWE who wants you to forget certain aspects. Yeah. They don't want you to remember that they had some sort of association because right after that, remember, he got hurt. And they kind of dropped the whole, you know, because they were building another faction with him. You know, it seems like it was going to be like another authority kind of thing pushing through. And then he got hurt and then, you know, he had to drop the belt. So, I don't know. I mean, for me, I think that Seth is going to win. I think Triple H is going to lay down for him. Like he should, because, I mean, like I said, you know, the old talent pushes the new. Mm-hmm. And it'll be interesting to see what they do with him, because he's kind of been, like, you know, hanging around in the universe, but he's, like, you know, that weirdo in the back of the room that you know is there, but you don't know what the hell he's doing. So that's my take on that. I think it's going to be, Zeth kind of picking up the win here.
Yeah.
And, that's if everything goes according to plan. And, then finally, we come to the Universal Championship. Goldberg, which is coming in as champion, versus Brock Lesnar.
The battle of the part-timers.
Oh, man. It's like, okay, you know, and the thing is, I think that this should be kind of interesting. This is kind of like, I wanted to say this is what they want to try to do is try to do like a Hulk versus Ultimate Warrior type of thing, where they have these two powerhouses kind of colliding. But every time we've seen them collide in the past,
it's been awful.
It's been awful. It's been a squash
match. I bet you so much money WWE is going to want you to forget about that match.
Exactly. Well, that's what we're saying. We're saying that there's no possibility that they can go ahead and kind of push this through without having the fact that he has squashed him two times. Mm-hmm. Two times. You know, I mean, it's ridiculous. And the thing is, they want us to think that this is going to be the main event. The main event is going to be amazing, full caliber, when the last two times it's like, huh, you fooled me once. Oh, you fooled me twice, you know. And then
that'll be interesting to see if this is going to be the one to close out the show. I can't see it closing out the show.
What do you see closing out the show? Bray and Randy?
Maybe Bray or Randy, or maybe Taker versus Roman.
I don't think they'd close the show.
You don't think?
I don't think they close the show. Unless, like I told you, unless the whole thing with that is that they're going to go ahead and The Undertaker's going to do his farewell speech and everything at WrestleMania. I mean, if it's going to close the door and lower that curtain, we're going to see it at the end.
Kind of like I can't say Flair and Michaels because they didn't close the show. But, yeah, maybe something like that. Maybe the second to last match. But I can't see the Universal Championship match closing the show.
And the thing is, I think the biggest reason why is because a lot of people have gotten used to this crap that they keep spoon feeding us. And it's like, you know, like I said, it's President Bush all over again. It's like, you know, fool me once, fool me twice, but you fool me a third time. And yeah, right? Because the thing is, that's what we don't know. We don't know if what we're looking at is going to be another ridiculous squash match, or if they're actually going to hold a decent match for 20, 30 minutes, and then, you know, Brock's going to take the win because of... I don't think he's going to win clean. I honestly don't think Goldberg's going to let him.
Yeah, Paul Heyman might get involved in that in some way.
Exactly. But, I mean, like I said, I think what's going to happen, and you can quote me on this, all right? You can watch this. I bet you he's going to be standing in his corner doing his little bounce thing, do-do-do-do-do-do-do, I'm bouncing, right? Or he's going to be in the middle of the ring, do-do-do-do-do, I'm bouncing.
Doing his UFC.
Exactly.
Little warm-up.
And here comes Goldberg, right? And he's going to grab the ref and toss him in front, and the ref's going to take the spear. Watch that. Or like I said, he's going to be in front of the turnbuckle. He's going to be do-do-do-do-do, and he's going to go right into the turnbuckle.
That would be great to see now, thinking about it. The ref taking the spear.
And watch.
It will be like a Triple H versus Taker at WrestleMania X7 when the ref is just dead for the whole match.
I honestly think that's what's going to happen. I think that's the way they're going to go ahead and carry it on. I think he's going to go ahead and toss the ref there.
That poor ref is going to be murdered.
Or he's going to be... If you automatically see a ref that you don't normally recognize ref this match... Right, a young ref, a young guy
not
come out there.
Earl Hefner.
No. I'm not talking about like the guy that can only get down and count once during the match because he can't get back up. No, I'm talking about a young guy that you like. I've never seen that ref before.
What's funny is recently, speaking of Earl Hefner, just getting sidetracked, he took a bump recently.
Really, Earl?
Yeah, he took a crotch shot, I think.
Nice.
Hefner's still going strong.
Yeah, right. Crotch shot number 342. So that's what, like I said, that's what we're going to see. We're going to either see Goldberg get hurt at the very beginning, which means like, you know, he's there in the freaking next to the turnbuckle, and he's going to rush him, and he's going to jump out of the way, and he's going to go and hurt his shoulder. He's going to go, I can't lift you now, you know? Or he's going to get the ref, and the ref's going to take the spear, and then he's going to be out for a bit.
And it's going to be like this no disqualification.
Just for a little bit.
Yeah, match.
Exactly. So he's going to lay down and then, you know, miraculously
stand up, you know, with like his ribs all broken.
Yeah, and the slow count. One. Oh, God, it hurts. Two.
I can't believe I got hurt by like a 59-year-old.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. And I think that's exactly what's going to happen. I think that's what we're going to see. We're going to see this match turn into something like that. It's just ridiculous, you know, show play. Just so that way Brock can walk away with the title and Goldberg could walk away with his head held high because he's like, oh, well, I wasn't beaten, you know?
The way I see it painted out WWE fashion, because, you know, I highly doubt they're going to do that ref bump. I don't see WWE doing that. Maybe Goldberg would charge in and Brock will either feed it into like a suplex or maybe the F5 itself, and it will be a squash match, but with Lesnar.
And, you know, and that's the thing. I don't necessarily think that's going to happen. I don't think it's going to be a squash. I think it's going to last a little bit, but there's going to be some sort of interference that goes ahead and kind of nail it out.
Yeah.
So, guys, you got our predictions. So this is it. For Universal Champion, you got Brock Lesnar. For WWE Champion, we got Bray Wyatt. I'm hoping Bray Wyatt,
but it's as of right now, it's like a unknown yet. Who knows what's going to happen?
Exactly. For the Raw Women's Championship, I got Charlotte Flair. I think she's going to go ahead and get that belt back.
Yeah.
Undertaker versus Roman Reigns. Roman Reigns. The United States Champion, Chris Jericho versus Kevin Owens. Kevin Owens. I think he's going to take that belt. AJ Styles versus Shane McMahon.
Styles.
John Cena versus The Miz.
John Cena,
of course. Yeah, oh, God.
We just started the meme in here.
The Raw Tag Team Champions. I think the club's going to retain it.
Too sweet.
There you go. SmackDown's Women's Champion. I think anybody but Alexa. Anybody but Alexa Bliss.
Anything but Alexa.
And then we have the Big Show winning the Andre the Giant Memorial Battle Royal. And then we got
the Cruiserweights.
Yep. And then Seth Rollins.
You know what's crazy? Hold on. We forgot one match.
Oh, yeah.
Dean Ambrose versus Baron Corbin.
No. We want to forget that match because we already know Dean. You know, Dean Ambrose is going to win that. Actually, I'm kind of hesitant on that. I think that they're going to give Baron the push, which I freaking hate. This is why I didn't want to discuss this match. Why the hell did you bring this up? Because
I just fed you into the hole of.
And this is a false count anywhere match.
Hey, Lord, that's going to be my kind of match. Even though, I swear, if they do another Brock versus Ambrose, which I think they are, I'm going to shit on this match like how I did last year with Brock and Dean. I mean, it was so sad because that match had so much potential. Chainsaws, everything. They had the moments, and it was just, ugh.
Yep, and, you know, like I said, I honestly think that I want Dean Ambrose to win. I think Baron's going to get the push. But, you know, and new news, Rob Van Dam has been teasing that he might be part of this Royal Rumble. Or not the Memorial Battle Royal. Yeah, sorry, whatever. Shut up.
It's going to get a little bit high.
Oh, yeah.
High flying in that Memorial Battle
Royal. Oh, that match is happening at 4:20. So, guys.
Paul Heyman will be in the back smoking a joint with Rob Van Dam with his red eyes.
All right, guys. So, we're going to go ahead and kind of leave it up to you. I hope you guys watch and enjoy WrestleMania. We're going to be there live, kind of going. We'll broadcast live from there, me and One Job.
I'll be updating MovieGeek_98 with on WrestleMania Instagram updates.
Yeah, so definitely check that out. Again, it's MovieGeek_98. On Instagram. Definitely check that out. Give them a follow. And guys, this has been One Job.
Hey.
And I am Deadpool Speaks, and you've been listening to our WrestleMania predictions. As always,
this is... Do, 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 do.
Oh, God. Okay.
Do, 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 do.
And I'm John Cena. All right, guys. So I'm Deadpool Speaks.
You can't see him.
I can now. Oh. And I'm out.
This has been a broadcast of the ESO Network, your station for all things geek, classic, current, and beyond. Be part of the crew at esonetwork.com.